Welcome to A la Mode. I'm your host, Lori Baudour, and today we are at Le Caprice at the Pierre Hotel in New York City. It's wonderful, it's marvelous, it's very elegant, and it's the perfect background for my dinner tonight with my friend and couturier, Norman Ambrose. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Lori. It's a pleasure to be here with you.
Have you ever been to Le Caprice in London?
I have not, but that's on my list of things to do, yes.
Well, let's make a date. We'll meet there again.
I think so.
But in the meantime, I know you're very busy with your collection. But let's start with your background. Where did you grow up and where did you study?
Well, I'm originally from San Francisco, California, from Northern California. Tiburon was the name of the town I grew up in. It was an old
area. Oh, it's beautiful.
It is lovely. You've been?
Yes, I have.
It's lovely. I miss it. It's very clean and bucolic. But I studied at the Academy of Art University in San Francisco, obviously. And I've moved up to New York 7 years ago. And I started my company 3 years ago.
Well, what did you do between those years when you first moved to New York and then opened your own company?
Well, I had several small jobs. One was working for 2.5 years at the Notori company under directive from Josie Notori. I was her assistant designer. I did a lot of visual research. I was in charge of prints and textiles. That's actually one of my majors in school. And after completing that stint, I took a year off, wrote a business plan, got family funding, and began my own venture into my business.
Well, God bless you. I mean, I just think your things are beautiful. This is
the
most beautiful jacket I've ever, ever worn.
You wear it well.
Thank you. But let's also talk about why you decided not to go into ready-to-wear, but actually haute couture.
Well, we do ready-to-wear, but I also do couture, that's correct. I felt that, especially in my generation, being that I am so young, many of my contemporaries don't dare to venture into that realm. And I've always had an appreciation and a love for finer clothes, finer sewing. So I felt it naturally was something that I should pursue since I was so drawn to it. And it's evolved. Over the last 3 years, with my ready-to-wear collection, we've brought on many custom clients for whom I design custom outfits, custom designs for all occasions. And the full nine yards, we go all the distance.
Well, that's wonderful. Well, obviously, this is a couture piece. This is a made to
order. It is. All the beading is hand done. It's done completely constructed in New York. We have a full floor atelier on 7th Avenue. So that was also a very important thing for me, was that everything that has my name on it that I produce has to be done in New York. I'm patriotic in that sense.
Well, that's wonderful. That's terrific. But define couture for me, custom made versus ready to wear. I think a lot of people don't understand the difference.
Well, ready to wear basically is off the rack. It's clothing that you buy in a size from a 2 to an 18 in a store. You take it off the hanger, go to the fitting room, try it on, walk out the door, basically. With couture or haute couture in Paris, it's high sewing or elevated sewing, where there are many different steps to produce a garment, and one most importantly is the fit of that garment. From a custom pattern, from the fittings in the toiles or the muslin, extensively 2, 3, 4 times depending on the style and the fit, and then going into the actual garment where you're fit again.
Well, there are not too many, as I understand it, maybe you tell us more about that, but I don't really know too many couturiers in the United States today. Of course, there was Galanos.
There's Ralph Rucci today. He's probably one of the most publicly recognized couturiers of the day, and he does perform those services.
Well, who are some of your favorite designers?
The most influential designer, inspiring designer to me, was Cristobal Balenciaga.
Ah, yes.
His last collection was in 1968, which was unfortunate, and he originally founded his house in Paris, had to close, and then reopened in Paris. And just his approach to making clothes, to designing, the attention to detail, how he took a woman's form, the body, into consideration when he was constructing, and then also taking the garment as more of an architectural aspect, really, you know, it excites me.
Well, I've noticed in your new collection that's coming out this week that you use several fabrications that are evocative of that time. You want to discuss a little bit about what we're going
to
see?
Well, wool jersey happens to be one of my favorite fabrics, not only because of its ease and its comfort, but also the weight, the way it can drape, and that it's just so easy to fit.
You remind me a bit in that respect also of I know you like Jeffrey Beam.
Mm-hmm.
He used a lot of those fabrications.
He did, and he was also a genius in his time, mm. and through his application of fabric and fit. So I'd say Jeffrey Beam too. I mean, it's difficult to pinpoint a single designer because throughout every decade, throughout every era, there are artists, designers, that they all have a point of view that is respectable and inspiring.
Well, that's great. Well, let's make it a little bit easier for you then.
Okay.
I want to know what pictures are on your board for inspiration. Who icons, not necessarily the designers, but
the people.
But the people.
Well, I'd say Grace Kelly is one. Mm-hmm. She looks a lot like my mother, so that's part of the draw.
Well, you have a beautiful mother.
I do. I not to boast, but I do. She's a beautiful woman.
And she has all your wonderful couture,
she
too.
She does. In the past, we made all of our sizes in her size, all of our sample
sizes.
Oh,
how lucky is she?
So when the collection is over and we're done selling, everything goes straight to her closet.
Well, not only is she beautiful, but she's the best dressed.
She is.
Well, who else other than Mommy?
I do have Audrey Hepburn,
mm-hmm.
Twiggy. Mm-hmm. I have some pictures by Richard Avedon, Irving Penn, Gene Shrimpton, who happens to be on the walls here in
exactly.
the restaurant. So, and then there are some that I don't know the names of, but they kind of embodied the spirit of the 60s, which was a tumultuous time culturally.
I was there. I don't know if you were.
I wasn't. I wish I was. I read about it, but I don't.
Well, we can talk more about that later.
Okay.
Anyway, I'm very excited about seeing this collection next week. And can you tell us anything about colors or fabrications or what to look for? What's special?
Well, I think one of the main themes is a play on menswear through the plaids and the herringbones and houndstooths that we have. I use a lot of wools. I find, especially in winter, the medium and lighter weights are very easy to sculpt, and they just fit the body beautifully, so they're great to tailor. I've also done some full furs now with
faux fur?
No, real fur.
Real fur?
Real fur.
Okay.
So I have some beautiful astrakhan, saukara lamb. We use some minks. I have this amazing, stripped mink that has been sewed down. It's double-faced onto a silk georgette, so it's almost weightless. The thing weighs about 13 ounces. It's
unbelievable.
Oh, my
goodness. Is it warm, though?
It's warm.
At the same time, it's warm,
but
it's light.
The fur, the way it's stripped, you still have the warmth of the fur. It's not as warm as a full coat would be, a full pelted coat. But it breathes, it moves with the body, and it does keep the heat in.
Oh, that sounds fabulous.
It's divine. I think that's kind of the future application for fur, being that, you know, most people, we don't really dress for the outdoors any longer unless we're in the country. At least living in the city.
That's a very good point.
So I think these modern applications are really quite futuristic. My color palette for the season ranges between a burnt umber. We have chocolate browns, a beautiful deep sage green, beiges and creams, a Roman stone color, which if you
what
can,
is a Roman stone?
Well, it's a stone. Generally, most people perceive it as gray stone.
Okay, right.
Well, picture Rome, Italy. I think of sun, it's warmer.
Terracotta?
Not quite that warm.
Oh, okay, not that warm.
Not that orange, but it's more of a yellow stone. So it's a beige, it's like a khaki beige stone. That's the best I can describe it.
It sounds
so
beautiful.
Colors. It's divine. And ivories, of course, and for evening we've gone into black, and we have some gorgeous leopard sequin, some feather embroideries.
Leopard sequins?
Yes, we do.
Oh, boy.
Yes, we do. Well, it's trompe l'oeil, and it fades to black. We do many feather embroideries, pearls, diamonds. I mean, it's all there. We have some fabulous cocktail dresses, too. It's very exciting. I can't wait for you to see it.
I can't wait either.
Excellent.
Now, where can we see this? Do you have a website that our viewers can go to?
Well, the current collection should be posted in about a month from today.
Okay.
However, they can see previous collections, and that website is normanambrose.com, and they're welcome to check that out.
Terrific. Well, I'm sure you'll have a lot of clicks going on. But in the meantime, thank you, and let's eat. And thank you for joining us today at Le Caprice with Designer Dish with my friend, Norman Ambrose. And thank you for tuning in to A La Mode with Lori Bodor. Bye-bye.